like to welcome you to our concert this afternoon and thank each and every one of you for coming to this event. You are in for a real treat. Please join us on a Sunday morning for worship at this church at 10 o'clock. We have two ministers. We have an 18-voice choir and a handbell choir and a chant choir. So I think you'd be very delighted if you came, and we'd certainly welcome you with open arms. I want to tell you where the bathrooms are. If you came in the front door, then you have to go down the steps into the dining hall, go through those doors to the right, keep going down the hall, and the bathrooms are on the other side of those double doors. If you came in the side door, you simply turn to the right and the bathrooms are right there. We are under a tornado watch, and if there is a real need to evacuate this area, I've been instructed to tell you to follow me, and I know where we can go to a very safe place in the building. But that's not going to happen, so don't worry about it. I would like to thank our sponsor for this concert. It's on the back of your program. It's David Bremner, and that's Ethan's father, and he has sponsored this whole event of the singers and the accompanists, so I'm very pleased. Concerts. If you have an idea of something that you would like to have me look into for an event here, for a concert, please let me know, as I'm going to be working on these over the summer. Your dinner tickets, you are going to need to show the people in the kitchen what it says on your ticket, so we don't have people changing their mind of what they ordered. So please do that. And you can go downstairs and take any seat you want after the concert for dinner, and we will have a blessing before we eat our dinner. So just wait for that to happen. So opera for the non-opera lover, I think after the concert, it's going to be titled Opera for the Opera Lover. So I turn this over to Ethan and Sol, and you're in for a real treat.
I don't need to use a microphone. That's not a thing opera singers like to do. We named the show Opera for the Non-Opera Lover with the idea that being someone from Athol, who was born and raised here for his first 18 years of his life, I was not exposed to opera until I left, which is unfortunate for me because opera became the love of my life, second to my wife. For the purpose of this program, I would normally just come right in up and sing something, but I want to treat this as maybe education, but also to just give you context and help you with the stories that these wonderful pieces of music come from. As such, each piece will be introduced either by myself or my amazing compatriot here, Soul Kim-Bentley. Thanks to, let's be honest, Uncle Ralph. We will have some translations. I'm hoping they will be large enough for everyone to read. This concert, as opera is in many different languages. We will be touching all of the major keystone languages of opera. That is, Italian, French, German, English translation, and even Russian. But to start, we'd like to start with something lighthearted. Now, I know the reputation opera has. Opera has a reputation of being a dreck and sad and just morose because everyone dies in the end. Well, that's not actually true. It happens a lot, and believe me, we'll do some of that. But there is also great comic opera, and one of my favorites is Le Désir d'Amore by Donizetti, which is Elixir of Love. And in the opera, the character Nemorino is the town fool. He is madly in love with the beautiful Adina. And she, in turn, is not that interested in him because he fawns over her and he is just kind of a fool. But a snake oil salesman visits town and he has the titular bottle of Elixir of Love. And he tells the foolish Nemorino that if he drinks this bottle, within 24 hours, domani, tomorrow, she will fall madly in love with him. But of course, this is all a ruse. The snake oil salesman is a snake oil salesman, and what he has actually sold him is a bottle of cheap wine. Now, he drinks the wine and he gets drunk, and in the process, he is also acting very cavalier, which she is very interested in because for the first time ever, he's not fawning over her. So, we will do the scene. Now, I need to warn you that this being a church, my father's church, I am not going to be drinking a full bottle of wine in the scene. I've got something a little more appropriate for the New England setting, shall we say. So I offer you the scene from Lisir d'Amore by Donizetti.
Domani a
hold up.
Sempre una.
I was cast in a show that would change my life for many, many reasons. The first and most important of which is that the person who I met shortly thereafter, the first time she saw me, ended up becoming my wife. But the second and also extremely important was meeting one of my favorite people on earth, my favorite soprano to sing with, and my favorite collaborator, Soul Kim-Bentley.
And the feeling is likewise, he is my favorite tenor. Like, I was just saying, if I had to like do an Avengers Assemble, he is the tenor I would want. So I will be singing the Jewel song. It's from an opera based on the Goethe novel Faust. The music's by Bruno. In this scene, so Faust is, he sells his soul to the devil, the usual thing, because he wants to like really live and get all the things he wants. So he's already done that. The devil has disguised him, and Faust really wants to find a nice girl to fall in love with him. So they go to the marketplace, and he sees Marguerite, and she's, you know, super dirty. She's just like a peasant girl. And he is this very sophisticated gentleman she meets in the town square. She gets home and there's this jewelry box sitting there that she doesn't know where it came from or what it is. And so she's like, oh, should I open it? Maybe I shouldn't. But oh, here's the key. And so she starts opening it. There's a mirror inside. It's full of jewels. And she's never seen such finery. And she's deciding, should I put on the jewels or not? Should I put on the first thing she puts on, I think, are earrings. And then you'll see her put on a necklace and a bracelet. But these are sort of cursed jewels. They are from Mephistopheles, or the devil. And she, when she puts it on, and she feels so amazing, even in her, you know, totally mud-stained clothing, she says, oh, if only that really handsome man I saw earlier today could see me now, he would think that I'm the daughter of a king. And the other thing that's sort of fun about this aria is that you could say it's the world's first unboxing video.
Thank you.
So we have done Italian, and you just heard French. So we're going to make our way through the languages. One of the often overlooked traditions is the Russian opera tradition. And it's a shame for me specifically because out of the Russian opera tradition comes what is my favorite opera, period, end of story. And out of that is my favorite aria, which I will be singing. And this being my hometown, I'm loving the idea that I get to share this with you. In Tchaikovsky's Eugene Onegin, the character of Eugene Onegin has established himself to be kind of frivolous and ignores the advances of a young girl in the first act, but then in the second act, he is at a party celebrating his best friend's engagement, and he flirts with his fiancée. His best friend is named Lenski, and Lenski sees this and catches this and flies into a rage and challenges Onegin, his best friend, to a duel to the death with pistols at dawn. I told you they're not all happy. Some of these are sad. And so, in the following scene, Lenski arrives at the duel site early, before Onegin, and he contemplates his fate, his life, and the situation that is presented before him. He will either kill his best friend or die himself. And he ponders life, and of course his fiancée, Olga. And unfortunately, if you think about it, this is midway through the opera, and the opera's not called Lenski. Onegin will win, but before that, Lenski sings his aria at the beginning of the duel scene. introducing our amazing accompanist, Mr. Wayne Ward. I particularly like singing that aria with him on piano. It is amazing to think of these great composers as people. And one of the things I enjoyed the most in studying music was thinking about that when discovering this fact. Later in this show, you will hear Soul sing an aria from Mozart. Mozart wrote tons of operas. Now, if I were to pick a random person in this room and say, after Mozart, or name two composers, what's likely to be the second composer you would name?
Beethoven.
You got it! Guess how many operas Beethoven wrote?
One.
One opera.
Fidelio.
His whole... That's right. His whole life, he worked on this opera. Rewriting and rewriting and rewriting. Isn't it amazing to think of these people as having self-doubt? Because that's what it was. He was comparing himself to Mozart his whole career. But, boy, did he write an amazing opera. In the opera Fidelio, the character of Florestan has been arrested and put in political prison in solitary confinement for 3 years. His wife, Leonore, has had enough and tries to free him. And so she poses as a man to work at the prison. She poses a man named Fidelio. And she ingratiates herself with the prison warden's family, in even going as far as maybe running into some trouble with the prison warden's daughter, who has a crush on her. Whatever. But the prison warden eventually warms to Fidelio, Leonore, and allows her to come down and see the prisoner he has kept in his cell in isolated solitary confinement for 3 years. She finds a Florestan utterly wrecked, an utterly destroyed man, who has literally only survived on the memory of her. But she comes to rescue him. This is one of the ones with a happy ending. And as such, they sing what I believe to be one of the happiest pieces of music ever written. And so I offer you the duet from Fidelio.
Oh,
She ends up stealing his watch, which is what he uses to lure women. It's like his special, it's his gimmick. And she steals it from him, and he's trying to get it back. And so his big ploy is, why don't you take your mask off? And she's like, no, I'm not going to do that. And he's like, I bet she's not even Hungarian. And so she's like, ha-ha, me? Not Hungarian? Oh. And so she sings this song to prove just how Hungarian she is.
Voice of my
In another just iconic aria that many of you will recognize, in Incavallo's I Pagliacci, the character of Cagno has just caught his wife in bed with another man. There's a lot of this in opera. And he is furious. But before he is able to exact his anger, he's told he's got to go on stage and play the clown, Pagliacci. And so he sings about putting on his makeup and his costume in the iconic aria, Vesti la Giura.
Oh, yeah. And I heard some powerful singers sing that one.
And he doesn't want to forgive her. So she first, you know, know, she says, okay. Just like hit me, get your anger out, and then let's make up. And see if you can find a moment where she knows he's never gonna hit her. But like she's just getting him to forgive her, and she's kind of manipulative. Anyway, have fun.
Oh,
turn you into at least opera appreciators, let's put it that way.
I see.
There are several people I need to thank for putting together this concert. First and foremost, I want to thank Ralph Cutter, who's been managing the subtitles up here. I assume I'm sponsor this whole thing, and more than anything, I want to thank I mentioned earlier that I did an opera production where I met Soul, and indirectly ended up meeting my wife, and that opera was La Boheme.
Oh, wow.
So, Puccini is maybe my favorite composer, and wrote just numerous fantastic operas, which I've had the pleasure of singing the lead in several of them. But I constantly keep coming back to Boheme. I think it's a great story, and the music is unbelievable. In the first act of the opera, the character of Rodolfo, who is a poet, is busy whiling away in his poor Paris apartment. They are very poor, but the stage is always very, you know, big and whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's working away, and knocking on his door is his new neighbor, Mimi. And she informs him that her candle is blown out. And he is immediately smitten with her and proceeds to help light her candle, but in the process, either by design or by deceit, she also loses her key. She passes out, but then why she loses her key may be deceit.
It could be.
It may be that Rodolfo is key. So they are then again searching on the floor as her candle has gone out again. And he touches her hand and he sings the aria Che gelida manina, which is your cold little hand, in which he introduces himself, says who he is, that he is a poet, and that he is, quite frankly, had a very recent inspiration for poetry in this new person he's met. But he'd like to know more about her, and so she then introduces herself in the aria Mi chiamo Mimi. They are obviously very smitten with each other, and so they decide, even though they just met, they decide, or they debate, whether they should go out together or stay in together. And they sing the duet, O suave fanciulla, and you will probably figure out that they do decide to go out together. And so we will do the scena from La Boheme.